To the Ridge Church. Good morning.
Oh yes, what a good response. I hope you all have had a good weekend so far, enjoying the sunshine. Yes, lots of sunshine. And so I think we're getting close to springtime maybe, right? And actually yesterday was the first day of spring, correct? What time did it start? Anybody know what time did spring start? What time was spring sprung in Carbondale, Illinois? Yeah, 4:37. I get confused on the time. So we've had a good day of spring, and we're on day two. So I want to welcome you to the Ridge Church. If you're watching online, check out all of the links in the description. Our announcements are in the worship folder, so I hope that you have one of those. And it has our Bible study events and all of those things that are in there. I want to thank all of those who assisted in the giveaway at Gorham yesterday. Chris is going to come in just a few moments and give us a report on that, but we had a good turnout of people helping and also those that picked up food, so that's good. March Ministry Outreach is candy for our Easter egg hunt, so I hope that you've got your candy, or you've brought it in, or provided some resources so that we go out and purchase some of the things that we need. But listen, this is your instruction, whether you've done anything with the Easter egg hunt or not, yeah, as of yet. This is your instruction online as well. So at Gorham, it is going to be next Saturday, the 27th, and at the Ridge Church, it's going to be the 28th, both times at 3 o'clock. But here's your assignment. Bring some children with you. We will have lots of eggs and lots of candy, so children, grandchildren, you see people wandering around the street, just pick them up, bring them all. You'll take them back. You're not going to keep them. But so that we can share our candy with them as well. Tomorrow evening at 5:30, we'll be here at the Ridge, and we'll be putting candy in Easter eggs. So if you'd like to help with that, you can see Linda Garlinghouse or Karen Dover. We're doing that tomorrow beginning at 5:30. Okay, our Maundy-Thursday service, April the 1st, it will begin at 6:15. It will be here in person. I will observe the Lord's Supper. We'll start at 6:15, and it will be right here at the Ridge Church on April the 1st. Easter Sunday at 7 o'clock, 7 a.m., we'll have a sunrise service. It'll be at the pavilion. There will not be breakfast following or Sunday school following, but we will have worship at 10:15. So 7 a.m. Easter Sunday, 10:15 a.m. Easter Sunday. We'll have two services, and you can come to both and enjoy them. And then Sunday, April the 11th, we are going to relaunch our small groups and Sunday school. And again, we will have Sunday school classes. We'll meet at 9 a.m. for that. And you're invited. Come on out to that. 9 a.m. Sunday morning beginning on April the 11th. April the 11th. Let's see. I know we're having some difficulties here. What's our next slide, Steve? Okay, yes. The week of prayer for North American Missions and the Annie Armstrong Easter Offering. In your worship folder today, you have a prayer guide. And so I want to call your attention to that. Be praying for these missionaries each day this week. Be praying about your gift to the Annie Armstrong Easter Offering. And all of the receipts from the Annie Armstrong Easter Offering goes to support missions at home in North America. So be praying about that this week, and we will have letters or envelopes for you next week on that. Where am I? I want to thank you. I want to thank you for your ministry with the Ridge Church, and because of your ministry, because of your service, as you give your tithes and your offerings and your times and talents, you are making a difference in God's kingdom. And just a reminder that you can give your offering by check. You can schedule your offering through your bank. You can give online. You can also give bring your offering here to the Ridge Church. So I want to thank you for your gifts and just remind you that God's work relies upon your faithfulness. Carissa's going to come. She's going to share with us what went on at Gorham yesterday. And so I want to make this connection, okay? Your tithes and offerings, what you give through the Ridge Church, help to support a ministry and a mission like we were able to do yesterday in Gorham. So just know that when you give, that there are results and it's used for God's kingdom. Chrissy, you come and you share with us, if you will, this morning.
Thank you, Wes. I just wanted to tell you a little bit about where the food came from. It was donated to the Illinois Baptist Disaster Relief from various people, companies across the United States. We have warehouses, trucks, everything involved has been donated. The food is sent from the warehouses to the churches, and the churches then take it out to the community. Yesterday, we served 45 families of over 140 people that were given food. We had at least 25 volunteers from the Ridge, the City of Gorham, the Gorham Fire Department, and Illinois Baptist Disaster Relief. We gave out things like bread, meatballs, hot dogs, cheese, pasta, some hygiene products, some cleaning products, just about everything. And we did have some food left over, and we were able to donate it to the Grand Tower Food Pantry, a full pickup truckload, that will then be given to people in the Bottoms, which includes Grand Tower and Gorham. So that food will still go to serve people in Gorham. And while we were able to provide food to nourish their bodies, more importantly, we gave them the message about Christ, the kingdom of God and salvation. And we did that through these little flyers that we had. And I'd encourage you to pick one up. It's at the back. I would encourage you to pick one up. It's an easy way to tell somebody about Christ, about how to receive salvation. It's just an easy door opener. So I want to thank you for the encouragement and all the people that came out to help. I don't want to list everybody because I'm sure I would forget somebody. But thank you for your help and for your prayers. Amen.
Thank you, Chris. And the Illinois Baptist Disaster Relief Organization is affiliated with the Illinois Baptist State Association. So that's our Southern Baptist State Association here in Illinois. Okay, let's begin our worship this morning. Our call to worship is from Lamentations chapter 3, verse 23. And let's say this together. Can we say this together? It's in your worship folder, so let's say this in unison. Are you ready? All right, here we go. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. God's mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness, O God. Amen.
Oh man, everybody needs to pray this morning. You should be praying anyway, but we need words, so would you stand as we sing freely, freely? God forgave my sin in Jesus' name. I've been born again in Jesus' name. And in Jesus' name I come to you to share his love as he told me to. He said, freely, freely you have received, freely, freely give. In my name, and because you believe, others will know that I live. All power is given in Jesus' name, in earth and heaven, in Jesus' name, and in Jesus' name.
share his power as he told me to. He said, freely, freely, you have received, freely, freely, give. Go in my name and because you believe, others will know that I live.
Let's pray. Father, again, we do thank you for such a beautiful morning. It reminds us of just how much, how so very much you love us and how much you give to us. And we take so much for granted, and we can't comprehend how great a love that you gave Jesus for our sin, that we can be close to you. And you continue to love us even when we fail. I pray, Father, that we open our hearts wider, that we can learn more, care more, and learn more about how much your love is, that you continue to love us freely. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You may be. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Old Testament book of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 55, and we will be looking at verses 1 through 9. It is written in your worship folder, Isaiah chapter 55, verses 1 through 9, and I'm reading from the New Living Translation. Before I start, I do want to set a little context here. Back in Isaiah's day, it was not uncommon for people to sell water. And they would sell water in these great big, I don't know, water drums, if you will, and they would go down the street and they would shout out, water, 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 just like the ice cream man today, right? And they would shout out water, and then you go up and you buy yourself some water. But every once in a while, there would be an individual who would want to be making a name for himself, kind of make a reputation for himself, to bring honor to himself. And so what he would do is he would buy the water in the tank, and then he would offer it to anyone who wanted to have it. And so you get free water. So as I read this, this is Isaiah chapter 55, verse 1, and he is not so much talking about the water that you drink, the physical water, but he's talking about spiritual water. Let's read. Is anyone thirsty? Come and drink. Even if you have no money, come take your choice of wine or milk. It's all free. Why spend your money on food that does not give you strength? Why pay for food that does you no good? Listen to me, and you will eat what is good. You will enjoy the finest food. Come to me with your ears wide open. Listen, and you will find life. I will make an everlasting covenant with you. I will give you all the unfailing love that I promised to David. See how I used him to display my power among the peoples. I made him a leader among the nations. You also will command nations you do not know, and peoples unknown to you will come running to obey. Because I, the Lord, your God, the Holy One of Israel, have made you glorious. Seek the Lord while you can find him. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked change their ways and banish the very thought of doing wrong. Let them turn to the Lord that he may have mercy upon them. Yes, turn to our God, for he will forgive generously. My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything that you could ever imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. May the Lord bless the reading of his word to us this morning.
Would you stand as we sing, Who You Say I Am?
Who am I that that the highest King would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me.
Who the Son sets free, who is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Ransomed me, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the Son sets free, who is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. The Son sets free, oh, he's free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes, I am.
May be seated.
Let's pray together. And as we pray this morning, let us thank the Lord that we are a child of His. Amen? A child of His. Let us pray this morning, and as we do that, let us be mindful of those who need to come to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And may that day be today. Let's pray for it to happen today as we pray. Let's pray together. Our Father everlasting, Lord Jesus, our crucified and risen Savior, Holy Spirit, our constant comforter, our triune God, you are the everlasting one. We believe in you. Father, in this moment of corporate worship, we gather as your created and redeemed image bearers, your beloved bride, the church, with minds focused on you and our hearts adoring you. With unity of spirit, we trust in you at all times. Lord, we ask that you would be with us this day as we commit ourselves to being your disciples. Help us to face the future unafraid, trusting in your loving care and your presence with us. Father, you know that we would like the ways of discipleship to be easy, to have the paths laid out in a neat line, with the future clearly visible at all times. God of compassion, forgive us of our sins when we falter, when the road ahead seems too uncertain and we are afraid. Lord, we admit that following Jesus is not an easy task. We know, Lord, that he requires us to be willing to make the ultimate commitment of our whole lives, and we hesitate, and we hold back, and we turn away. But Lord, draw us back to you. Give us confidence and courage to face the future with hope. And Lord, even though the way forward is often clouded, we rejoice that you are with us, and you guide us, and you heal us, and you comfort us, and you restore us. Father, write your words on our hearts. Plant your love that transforms our lives in our spirit. Give us courage. Father, as we've gathered here this day in these moments, we bring before you our concerns and our joys and our sorrows. Grant us hearts of peace and confidence as you are present with us and sustain us. And Father God, this morning we lift up before you all those who are facing illness today. And Father, as we pray silently, we pray for these who are hurting today, for those that are grieving today, for those who are sick today. Lord, we bring their names before you at this time. Lord, we ask that you bring healing, comfort, and peace to their bodies, that you calm their fears, and allow them to experience the healing power of your love and your presence today. We pray in the name of Jesus, the one who taught his disciples to pray when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
I stood in the courtroom, the judge turned my way. "It looks like you're guilty, now what do you say?" I spoke up, "Your Honor, I have no defense. But that's when mercy walked in. Mercy walked in and pleaded my case, called to the stand. God said, blood was presented to cover my sin. Forgiven when mercy walked in. I stood there in wonder, how could someone so guilty had just been set free. My chains were broken, I felt born again the moment that mercy walked in. And pleaded my case, called to the stand. God's saving grace, the blood was presented that covered my sin. The moment that mercy.
Thank you, Jeff. And all the people said, amen. 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 Forgiveness came when mercy walked in. Aren't you glad for God's mercy? Amen. Amen. I'm glad for God's mercy. Sometimes people will ask me during the week, they'll say something like, "Preacher, what are you preaching on Sunday?" And preachers like to do that to other preachers. They kind of like ambush them, you know. Like and then they'll tell you what they're preaching on, and they'll give you the whole sermon like they're trying it out on you to see how it goes. So people ask you, they'll say, you know, what are you preaching on Sunday? And if I don't know what I'm preaching on, or I don't have it together, or I'm not sure, rather than, you know, saying I don't know, because who'd want to say that to another preacher, right? I mean, it just wouldn't be good. And to someone else, I usually say, when someone asks me, what are you preaching on Sunday, I usually say, I'm preaching on sin. And I'm against it. And that really does a pretty good job, because who ought not to be against sin? However, this morning, I am really preaching on sin, and I am really against it. So I just want to put that out there today. You ask some folks about what they need to do to go to heaven. And a lot of times people will say, you just need to be good. Good people go to heaven. I remember reading an autobiography of Harry Carey. Harry Carey, For those of you who are young and not as old as Jeff is, you may not know who Harry Carey is, but Harry Carey was a baseball announcer for the St. Louis Cardinals for many years, and then with the Chicago Cubs. So I was reading his autobiography, and somehow or another, one of the chapters he talked about dying and about going to heaven and all of that. And his philosophy was that when you go to heaven, God will take all of your good deeds, all the good things that you've done, and then he'll compare them with all the bad things that you've done. And somehow, like, I don't know, put them on a scale or count them up or whatever. And if your good deeds outweigh your bad deeds, He said he thought that you go to heaven. And of course, he thought his good deeds outweighed his bad deeds, and that's where he was going to go. And when people say good people go to heaven, you'll listen to them, and they will continue on to say how that they are a good person and that they ought to be going to heaven. But I want to know if anyone can really pass the I am a good person test. Now, I'm going to ask some questions, and please don't answer out loud, okay? Just don't answer. Don't answer. I just keep it to yourself. But have you ever taken something that doesn't belong to you? Yesterday, Debbie and I were at the tax people's place getting our taxes done. That's a whole nother story. But while we were there, the person, we had to sign some things with an actual pen, and they handed us a pen. And I'm thinking to myself, you know, that would look good right here in my pocket. But I knew I was going to be talking about that today, so I didn't take the pen. But have you ever, you know, taken something that doesn't belong to you? Maybe a pen. Maybe you're walking through the Kroger place, right? The Kroger supermarket, and there are these grapes that are there, and you look over to those grapes, you kind of pick up a couple of grapes, and you kind of eat them, just test them to make sure they're good or not. Have you ever had anger in your heart? Have you ever harbored anger? Have you ever taken the Lord's name in vain? Not on purpose, but you hit your thumb with the hammer and who knows. Have you ever talked about someone? Well, it's true, but you know, gossip can be true, but the Bible explicitly says that we ought not to gossip. That's a sin. Have you ever talked about someone? If you answered yes to any of these questions, then sin has impacted your life. And then here's another question I have. Who decides what is sin, right? Who decides what is sin or what's not sin? I mean, we know it's not like we ask our neighbors. It's not like we come to some agreement that within our neighborhood. We don't add it to the neighborhood covenant and say, you know, these things are sins. We don't do that. As believers in Jesus, as Christians, we believe that God has a right to determine what sin is. Chris has shared that little sharing of the gospel, and when you share the gospel, the first thing you tell folks is that God created everything. God's in charge. God makes all the rules, and he has the right to because God creates his world. Who determines what sin is? It's what God says. And the ultimate authority of determining sin is the Bible, the Scripture. It's not a poll that we take. It's not a culture. It's not what culture says. It's not what society says. It's not what everybody else is doing or not doing that determines what sin is. But God determines what sin is. And the authority for determining that is the Bible. And so our lives are impacted by sin. The Apostle Paul has something to say about our sin predicament. And if you have your Bibles, I invite you to turn with me to Romans chapter 3. We're going to read just a few verses, but I would encourage you to read the whole chapter. But Romans chapter 3, we're going to read verses 9 through 12 and then verses 23 through 24. And this is Paul talking about the fact that we're all sinful and the impact that sin has on our lives and our whole society and our whole world. Verse 9, what shall we conclude then, Paul writes? Do we have any advantage? Not at all. For we have already made the charge that Jews and Gentiles alike are all under the power of sin, as it is written. And then Paul goes on, he's going to quote here some various psalms and Old Testament scriptures. As it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. Then verse 23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. So let me give you our take home this morning, give you right off the top. because I want you to get it. I want you to know it. I want you to be thinking about it this morning. But this is our take home. And our take home is this, that sin affects all of us. All of us, every one of us. Sin has its effect on us. And our only hope in defeating the impact of sin is a relationship with Jesus. You see it up there on the screen. We're all affected by sin, and we are without hope except for a relationship with Jesus. So I want to, and you might say, well, you know, I know that. I know that. If you're a follower of Jesus, you say, I know that. What's the big deal? If you are a follower of Jesus already, you have a relationship with Jesus, and that is true, our take-home is true, then we ought to be excited about it. We ought to be more thankful about it. We ought to be more intense on following God's will and direction for our and calling for our life. And if you do not have a relationship with Jesus, you need to have one this morning. Before you leave here today, you need to receive that relationship with Jesus so that you might have life that lasts forever and that you will be able to defeat the impact that sin has upon our society. So I invite you to follow along with me this morning as we're going to focus, first of all, on the bad news. I got good news and bad news today, right? We're going to focus beginning on the bad news that's tied to sin, and then we're going to look at the good news of hope that's found in Jesus. So let's take a look in verses 9 and 23. Here's the bad news. The bad news is, number one, we are all under sin. We're all under sin. Verse 9, verse 23. Verse 9 says, Jews and Gentiles alike are all under the power of sin. And then in verse 23, Paul continues. He says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And there's two key words in these two verses that we need to look at. The first word is all. All. What does all mean? All means all, right? It shows that every one of us is impacted by sin. Yes, we try to be good. We strive to be good. I mean, we're here this morning. That's good, right? But no one will ever be good enough. No one will ever be good enough. James, in James chapter 2, verse 10, he tells us that it only takes one sin to condemn us. You know, I kind of like writing down everything that's sinful because then I can cross off a bunch of things that I don't do, right? Write down all these sins. I mean, I can fill up pages and pages of sins of what the Bible says is sin, and I can cross off all those ones that I don't do. But really, that's not the issue. It's those ones that I do. And James says in James chapter 2, verse 10, he says, whoever keeps the entire law yet stumbles at one point is guilty of breaking it all. It's not three strikes and you're out when it comes to God. It's one strike and you are out. It's all over. So all of us are affected that way. And then the second word is under. In verse 9, Jews and Gentiles alike are all under the power of sin. And what that word means, to be under, it means to be governed by or controlled by someone or something. And even though we may strive and try and be successful 98% of the time to be a good person, according to God's word, according to the scripture, it is sin that is governing our life. It is sin that is controlling us. So that's bad news. We're all under sin. And here's some more bad news in verse 10. No one is righteous. Paul says, no one is righteous. There is no one righteous, not even one. And the word righteous here means to be in right relationship with someone. So a couple who is striving to communicate with each other, trying to serve one another, trying to meet the needs of each other. If they're trying to do that, that means that they are striving or trying to be in a righteous relationship with one another. They're trying to, you know, work things out and work together and communicate and help each other out. But verse 10 says that there is no one who is in a right relationship with God. We can work as hard as we want to work. doing good things, but we will not achieve a right relationship with God on our own. I don't care how good you are. Okay, I don't care how good you are. I was going to say, you know, point somebody out. I don't care if you're as good as, but I'm not going to do that. I already got Jeff mad at me for calling him out during the service. But I don't care how good we are. It's not good enough to ever achieve a right relationship with God on our own. And then there's more bad news. We're all under sin. That's bad news. There's no one who is righteous. That's bad news. And then in verse 12, it says we have all turned away. That's bad news. We've all turned away. In case there's any doubt about how dire the situation really is, Paul tells us clearly that we have turned away from God. We have turned our back. That's what he means. We have turned our back on the Lord. It's a personal choice that we make in which we no longer trust or have confidence in someone or something. So we have turned away from God. We no longer have confidence, no longer trust God as we should. It's a personal choice, and we have no one to blame but ourselves about that choice. We did it. We did it. It's our choice to turn away from God. You know, we often think of sin as in terms of what we do, not in terms of who we are. We sin because we're sinners. Sinners sin, and that's why we sin, because we are sinners. And sometimes we fool ourselves by focusing on the sinful act. And I said this before, just a few moments ago, we make all of our sin lists, and then we do all of our comparisons. And all of our rationalizations, you know, we compare, yeah, I do this, but I don't do this, I don't do that, what that person does, right? I'm, you know, yeah, maybe it's not exactly, you know, right, but at least I don't do this. We make those kind of comparisons. And then we make rationalizations, like, well, I know it's wrong, but you see, this is why it's okay for me to do it. So we make those rationalizations, we make those comparisons, we make those lists, and we spend a lot of time doing that, and we compare ourselves with one another in the church and outside the church. But really, that's a waste of time, because that's not the issue. It's not the issue at all. The reality is that we are sinners by birth. Adam and Eve sinned, and they passed it down to us. And I wish that's where we could stop. And say, you know, the reason why I sin is because of Adam and Eve. But we're also sinners by choice. We choose to. We choose to sin. And if we're going, you know, that's our situation. That's the bad news. We're under sin. We're not righteous. We've turned our back on God. And we are separated from God. And there's no hope based upon that. And we could stop right there this morning. And we'd get out early. But we'd walk away from here depressed and discouraged. We'd throw up our hands because we are all under sin. And we're not righteous. No one is. And we've turned our backs on the Lord. But the Lord provides us hope. The Lord provides us hope. The Bible provides us hope. The Bible talks about sin and the seriousness of sin and the fact that, you know, we can't change what sin is just because we live in 2021. Sin is sin in 2021, the same as sin was sin in the year 2, if you will, or the year B.C. 610 or whatever. Sin is sin. We can't change that. But the Bible provides us hope, and our hope is not found in our good works. It's not found in trying to balance the scale and making sure that we're heavier on the good works than the bad works. But our hope is provided through a right relationship with Jesus. Notice here, verse 24, the good news of hope that's found in Jesus. Verse 24 says, all, that same all. You see that? That same all. All are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. Those who believe in Jesus are justified. all those who have placed their faith in Jesus and believe him to be the Son of God, who takes away the sins of the world, takes away my personal sin, they are justified. They are justified. And that word justified is a legal term. It's a legal term. It means to be declared righteous. Remember we talked about being no one being righteous, no, not one? To be justified is a legal term that means that we have been declared righteous. Those who are unrighteous are declared by order of the court to be righteous in Jesus. And furthermore, it means a little bit more than that. It also means that we are continually being made justified, or we are continually being made righteous over and over and over and over again, even as we find ourselves engaged maybe in whatever that behavior is that we do not desire, you know, that sin that so easily besets us. God is continually there declaring us to be righteous because of our relationship with Jesus. Doesn't the scripture say that the Son sits at the right hand of the God, at the right hand of God, interceding in our behalf? The Son sits at the right hand of the Father, over and over and over again, justifying us and making us righteous in all the things that we do. Those who believe are justified. That's the good news of hope. And the second part of that is, how do we become justified? How do we get that? You know, how do we get the court to declare that we are justified, and how do we get the court to declare that we are righteous? What do we have to do? Now, I don't know if you've ever been involved in court proceedings. And again, don't raise your hand. I don't know if you've ever been in court proceedings, but, you know, there are some things that you can get the court to do if you pay the right amount of money, if you get the right lawyer, if you find the right judge. You know, it's all legal, but you have to kind of work at it. You know, is that how we are declared righteous before God? Is there something that we have to do? But notice what this verse says, this verse 24. It says that all are justified, how? Freely, by God's grace. We receive our righteous standing before the Father due to the freely given grace in our behalf. We can't earn it. You know, the good works that we try to do to appease God, to get on the good side of God, they don't work. This free gift of grace is given by the Lord, by the Father. And we define grace. What is grace? We define grace in many ways, but one way is it's God's unconditional love expressed toward us. So I want to give you, this is our standing before the Lord. As the Lord looks at us, if you want to use this illustration, I don't know, as the Lord looks at us, looks down on us from on high, okay? This is our standing before God. He looks at you. He looks at me. And he concludes that we are under the control of sin. Sin governs us. He determines that we have deliberately, on purpose, turned our back on the Lord, on him. He has determined that we are totally, completely undeserving of God's love and acceptance. And yet, God freely bestows his grace upon us. Isn't that amazing? I mean, that's just wow. You see, some people, when they think about God, they see God as some angry type figure who seeks to punish everyone he encounters. You get out of line, you get out of step, God's right there, and he's going to punish you. That's the way a lot of people look at God. But the Bible, as we read the Bible, as we look at the scripture, it provides a completely different view of God. Instead of being judgmental, God warns us
that we're all sinful. Instead of seeking to punish us, as God has every right to do, instead of seeking to punish us, God sent Jesus to take our punishment upon him. God sent Jesus to take our punishment upon him. And so we have to understand the bad news of sin first before we can get to the good news of hope that's found in Jesus. Our justification, our redemption, our salvation is found only one way, and that is in a relationship with Jesus. And so here's the response this morning. Here's the application today. Here's what I'm moving toward this morning, if you will. Number one, do not leave here without a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Those of you who are here, don't leave this building this morning. Those of you who are watching online, don't turn off the stream until you are sure of that relationship with God that is provided through Jesus Christ. And then secondly, if you have that relationship, be thankful. Be thankful. Praise God for your salvation. And you see, the test of your gratitude, the test of how grateful and thankful you are, is linked to your willingness to follow God's direction for your life. Are you thankful for what the Lord has done? Are you grateful? Are you, amen, glory, hallelujah? Well, you know, anybody can say those words, but the test of it is seen in how willing we are to follow God's direction and calling in our life. So where is God directing you this morning? Ask the Lord to give you the strength to follow him. However the Holy Spirit is leading you today and what you need to do for him today, you do that. We're going to sing this hymn. We're going to sing, Lord, I'm Coming Home. I'm going to be standing over there. Debbie's coming right now, and she's going to lead us. And as she comes to lead us, as Carissa comes to play, if you have a decision to make, you come and you make that decision as we stand together and as we sing this morning.
I've wandered far away from God. Now I'm coming home. Paths of sin too long I've trod. Lord, I'm coming home. Coming home, coming home. Nevermore to roam. Open wide thine arms of love. Lord, I'm coming home. I've wasted many precious years. Now I'm coming. With bitter tears, Lord, I'm coming home, coming home, coming home, nevermore to roam. Open wide thine arms of love, Lord, I'm coming. Straying, Lord, now
And now, may the grace, the peace, and the love of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be upon each and every one of you today and forever. Amen. Thank you.